welcome to St. Bartholomew's. I'm excited. This is my first ever Kirkin of the Tartans. So I'm excited. Is this on? Okay. This is my first ever Kirkin of the Tartans, so I'm excited to see this in action. Before we begin, I'm just going to do some brief parish announcements. There will be no prayers of the people this morning because of the way this unique service is structured, but we want to acknowledge those observing birthdays this week right now. So happy birthday to Mary Jane Campercioli and Mark Fumick. The next vestry meeting is going to be this Thursday, November 16th at 7 p.m. All are welcome to attend. The training session for ushers will occur on Saturday, November 18th at 1 p.m. and will likely be not very long. Anyone interested in serving as usher during worship is invited to attend, whether you've expressed interest yet or not. If you're interested but not available on Saturday, please speak to me and we can arrange a brief private session. The next session of Episcopal Beliefs and Practices, our teaching series, is going to be November 26th. It's going to be kind of a tag team between myself and Russ Trippi. It's going to be an Advent wreath making workshop, complete with a history of the Advent wreath and some information about the liturgical calendar. The Community Meal Ministry is having its second community meal, the Welcome Table. It's occurring the fourth Sunday of each month at 1 p.m. at Church of the Epiphany in Euclid. Please speak with me if you're interested in taking part in that. Sunday school is available for any children present today. It has just started and it's in the room, almost the farthest room away from we are on the far other side of the building if you have kids you want to take over there. Please see the block note and other and the website for other information and upcoming events. And without any further ado, let's begin the Kirkin of the Tartans.
Thank you.
With the God of love,
may we be warm and loved.
With the justice of Jesus,
may we be challenged and made whole.
With the breath of the Spirit,
may we be filled with laughter and dancing. Amen.
Please pray with me.
Almighty and everlasting God, all things are sanctified and enlightened and made perfect by your love and power. Be merciful to us and bless us. Cause your face to shine upon us, that what we do now may please you and show forth the honor of your name. These things we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Gospel. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamp and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him.' Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise replied, 'No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves.' And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later the bridesmaids came also, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he replied, 'Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Bridesmaids, 5 foolish and 5 wise, fall asleep waiting for the long-expected coming of the bridegroom so that the wedding ceremony can finally begin. When they wake, they learn he's coming, and five foolish ones are frightened to learn that they did not bring enough oil to keep their lamps lit for his arrival. After asking for some oil from their wiser peers and being rejected, they run out in the middle of the night, hoping the oil merchant will be able to provide for them, only to return and find themselves locked out and unable to enjoy the festivities. There's one way to interpret that parable that makes itself quickly and plainly known. When Jesus comes to reclaim the earth, it is only those who are ready who will be allowed to bask in his glory. Those who follow the rules have all the right boxes checked off and always diligently remember to bring extra oil will enjoy the warm embrace of Jesus. But the rest who fail to keep the commandments will be left out in the cold. Friends and guests, every fiber of my spirit revolts against that interpretation. My study of scripture and theology and my prayerful attempts to come closer to understanding who God is and what God wants from us simply can't accept such harshness and lack of mercy from our benevolent ruler. Part of why I feel this so strongly is because I find that in some way, every one of us is a foolish bridesmaid. If we are the Girl Scouts and Boy Scouts who are always prepared with an extra flask of oil, then there must be some other way we fall short. We are human after all, and are all subject to the vanities and frailties of human nature. We all succumb, frequently, to our weaknesses of temptation to sin. If admittance into God's kingdom depends on our ability to never stray from biblical commandments, then we're going to be talking about a very lonely and empty kingdom, rather than one pulsating with the joys of eternal life. So no, I don't believe there's anything we can do to secure our seat at the great wedding banquet. It is Jesus who forgives our sins and prepares that space for us. And thank God for that. The other reason I rebuke the quick interpretation is because I don't believe Jesus means to honor the behavior of the five wise bridesmaids. Let's think about it. They all have more oil than they need and could comfortably share the small amount necessary to greet the bridegroom if they wanted. Are we to believe that Jesus is saying we should only be concerned about our own salvation and not that of others? That we should not consider ourselves people of sacrifice? That we should enjoy our sumptuous feasts without caring about the hungry outsiders left in the cold? There is simply too much evidence from his other teachings and his actions that counter those questions for me to accept that reading. So the question remains, how do we refresh our understanding of this inscrutable and frustrating parable in a way that feels more consistent with the larger theological framework we find in the Gospels? If we read in this parable that the wedding banquet represents the coming kingdom of God, and I think we should because at least that much is consistent across other teachings, then do we really think that God would kick us out for something as small as forgetting to bring oil? In an attempt at saying what God actually wants from us, I'm going to break one of my own rules. And I'm going to quote a Christmas hymn well before Advent has actually begun. Consider the final stanza of Christina Rossetti's poem, In the Bleak Midwinter. What can I give him, poor as I am? If I were a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. Yet what I can, I give him, give my heart. Part of the reason why I say we are all foolish bridesmaids is because we all have what I would call spiritual MacGuffins. We all have things that we fool ourselves into thinking are essential to our salvation, things that drive a lot of our action and our ministries. We tell ourselves that God won't love us or welcome us into heaven if we don't follow every commandment perfectly, or if we're ever late to church on Sunday morning, or if we don't work hard enough or pray hard enough. If we struggle with doubt, or if we aren't generous enough, and on and on and on and on. While there is a Christian ethic that we disciples try as hard as possible to hold ourselves to, and while God is pleased with our efforts at intentional worship, we cannot let those things make us lose sight of the fact that simply stated, God loves us, And even when we fail to be the picture-perfect storybook Christian, Jesus forgives our sins. At the end of the day, what God wants from us is, as the poem said, our hearts, opened up to be filled with that same radical divine love that will then be poured out from us and reveal the kingdom of God to the world. When we put too much importance in the little things like having enough oil in our lamps or all those other more actually relevant to our lives things I named a minute ago, and when we scramble to make ourselves feel worthy of salvation, we deny the kind of radical love God has for us and put distance between ourselves and the warmth of intimacy with our Creator. But when we accept that love, in spite of all the reasons we might feel we don't deserve it, we feast on it. And when we let the light of God shine out of our hearts to our neighbors, we invite others to that feast. And the banquet table spreads ever wider. Amen.
Amen.
Standing as we are able, let us read the affirmation of faith from the Scott Confession on the middle page of the front side of your bulletin. We confess one God alone,
to whom alone we must cleave, to whom alone we must serve, to whom alone we must worship, and to whom alone we put our trust. God is eternal, infinite, immeasurable, incomprehensible, omnipotent, one substance and yet distinct in three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, by whom we confess and believe in all things, in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, directed and created, and immovable and guided by the indescribable providence. Sustained in his eternal wisdom, good and justice have been appointed to the manifestation of his own glory.
Please be seated. With that, I ask the presenters to come forward, face the altar, and of course, select the presenters from the cards of the announcers.
David Norris offers the ancient Anderson tartan in honor of James McGregor Norris.
This tartan, presented by William Grant, is the Grant Red Modern tartan, being presented in honor of Mr. and Mrs. E.J. Grant. Tartan presented by Dave Lightfoot. The tartan name is the Rose Tartan. presented in memory or honor of James and Hannah.
Victoria Stopek offers the Drummond Tartan in memory of Betty Vangerver.
This tartan, also presented by Dave Leifer, is presented as the Clan McLaren tartan. It is presented in memory or honor of the Boy Scouts of America.
Robin and Violet Baker offer what appears to be the Black Watch, the 42nd Highland Regiment tartan, in memory of Mary Elizabeth Haas. Rose McIntyre offers the McIntyre tartan in memory of Joseph McIntyre.
Thomas Moore Scott presents the Scott tartan in honor of his 44 years of marriage.
Our friend Elizabeth Duncan offers the Duncan tartan in memory of Bill Duncan, the past president of the Scottish Heritage Association of Northeast Ohio and Clan Grant.
This tartan, presented by Dwayne Mills, is the Clan Gordon tartan. It is presented in memory of William Mills.
Scott and Jean Duncan offer the Ancient Duncan tartan in memory of Gloria and Bill Duncan, the past chief of the Scottish Heritage Association, and also in memory of Martha and Harold Snyder. You see now the Duncan Ancient tartan.
This tartan, presented by Joe Gambatese, is the Dress Stewart tartan, presented in memory of Joe and Angela Gambatese. Also presented by Joe Gambatese is the Ancient Anderson tartan, presented in memory of Joe and Mary Campola. Joe also presents the Clan Grant tartan in memory of Judy Gambatese.
Jenny Mae Karachi offers the Dress Stewart tartan in memory of Cleta May.
Terry McEntee and Terrell Larinas present the tartan for the Innes clan, presented in honor or in memory of Janet McEntee, Jesse Wright, and Christina Terrace.
Rosemary Kremlik offers the Royal Stewart tartan in memory of, in honor of all of our safety forces. The Royal Stewart tartan.
for Stuart Rigger, the Aberdeenshire Regional Tartan, in memory of his maternal grandparents, James and Daisy Singer.
Our friend Bob Durack offers the Royal Canadian Air Force tartan in memory of his dad, Robert Durack, a World War II veteran, and his uncle David Durack, also a World War II veteran, and in memory and honor, rather, of his uncle Elroy McCurry, a World War II veteran, and Joseph Absher, also a World War II veteran. Thank you, Bob.
I'm Chuck Cashin, and I'm presenting this Lament tartan this morning in memory of my dad, Charles Bud Cashin. Also, Sherry, my wife, brings forward the Laxey Manx tartan. It's in memory of my dad, and it's the other half of my Celtic ancestry.
Edna Anderson brings forward the Hunting Macintosh tartan in memory of past chief John Noble and Viola Noble and Albert and Margaret Noble and Lloyd and Marjorie Staples. The Hunting Macintosh tartan.
Janet Federer and family bring to us the Northwick tartan. In memory of Ian and May Doreen, Jim Federer, and Stephen Katz.
And Edna Anderson also brings forward the Anderson tartan in memory of Korean War veteran Frederick Anderson and Carolyn Anderson. James Baxter offers the Hatta tartan in memory of his grandparents, James Alexander Rainey and Adeline Hatta Rainey.
Carol Leslie presents the Leslie tartan in memory of Bob Leslie, grandfather.
Lynn May also brings forward the Ohio tartan in memory of Bob and Janet Harris and Cleta and Tom May. And the Cleveland Heights Scottish Country Dance Group offers the Clan Grant tartan in memory of Hal Burke. Clark Langmark offers the Black Watch tartan, the head of the 42nd Highland Regiment, in memory of Charles, Sven, and Virginia Langmark.
Clark Langmark presents the Dress Leslie tartan in memory of George, Doris, and Christopher. Clark also presents for us the Hunting Leslie tartan in honor of Dorothea Kingsbury. Liz now presents for us the Royal Stuart tartan in memory or honor of Mary and Ernest Brass and Meta Walker.
We offer this as a blessing to not only these, but to our kinsmen everywhere. Almighty God, you have promised that in all places where you record your name, you will lead your servants and bless them. Fill now your promise and make us joyful in our prayer, so that our worship may be offered in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and by the guidance of your Holy Spirit, may be acceptable to you and profitable to ourselves. Bless us, we pray, in these times, that they may be to us and all a token of faith in our ancestors and the sign of our service to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now that everyone gathered here, I invite you to share a sign of God's peace with your neighbor. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Thank you.
teach them and to lead them into all truth, uniting peoples of many tongues in the confession of one faith, and giving to your church the power to serve you as a royal priesthood and to preach the gospel to all nations. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into this world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
One final thank you to Shano, to all our visitors, to all who brought tartans. And I also wanted to say a word of thank you to our parish cook, Richard, who has prepared quite a feast for us in the parish hall that I hope everyone here comes and fills up on. So please join us and our community and everyone else at the parish feast. There'll be dancing and other things. That'll be right after the service. And for the final blessing, the peace of Christ that passes all understanding, may keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
And let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.